Hey, good morning, Lighthouse Church family, and anyone that would be joining us today live or later today or this week. Happy Resurrection Sunday. Without the Resurrection Church, we would have no reason to celebrate. There would be no hope, but praise the Lord, we can come together today over digital means, and we can worship the risen Savior. Amen. I pray right now that you would just join in to us, join in with worship, and you would enter in and engage. I pray right now that you would just take every distraction that you've got going on in your life and you would just put it aside as we come together this morning and we worship the risen Savior. If you don't have the lyrics or whatever we're singing today, you can actually go to Lighthouse Facebook page, and I've got all the three songs on the Facebook where you can actually see the lyrics. You can follow along. We're going to have a good time worshiping the Lord. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that we can worship you together. And we just ask you, Lord God, to just no matter where we are meeting today, whether it's in a living room or in a bedroom, or it doesn't matter where we've joined together at this morning, but we're joining together with you, Lord, and we're coming together to worship you, our risen King. I ask you, Lord God, right now to bless this worship team as we enter into a place, Father, where we're just going to focus strictly on you. Bless everyone that may be watching this morning. I pray right now, Lord, that your spirit would just go and just begin to minister to hearts and change lives. Right now, I pray, give us your peace that passes all understanding. It's in Jesus' name, and all of God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Let's worship the Lord.
Blood of Jesus, nothing can.
Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin. took the nails for me. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day.
Glory to God. I don't care what anybody says. We can have church from anywhere.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Walking around this morning in this sanctuary, and you see who's with us this morning. You see our worship team. That's who's in this house this morning. Brother David Claiborne's with us, worshiping the Lord. But it's just us. And I'm not going to lie, I'm emotional right now. It'll pass, maybe. Maybe it won't. But as I'm walking through this house, praising the Lord, reminded of his empty pews this morning, my heart began to be pulled a little bit, and the Lord reminded me 2,000 years ago, hallelujah, the tomb was empty as well. And because the tomb was empty, it doesn't matter if we're here together, if we're joined in on Facebook. Jesus is still King, hallelujah, and he's still risen, and he's still saving souls, and he's still in control, hallelujah.
Amen.
Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. Whether you're tuning in this morning for the first time at Lighthouse Church, or you've been watching every week, I want you to know this morning Jesus loves you. There's nothing he wouldn't do for you. There's nothing he wouldn't do to get your attention. There's nothing he wouldn't do to let you know how much he loves you and wants you to serve him. Whew, hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Somebody give Jesus a hand clap. You can't give him one here, but you can. Hallelujah. Tell him you love him. In your homes right now, you can listen. In your homes, you can stand to your feet. You can lift your hands. You can worship Jesus. You don't have to be in this home, this church house with us. You are the church. You are a child of God. Jesus is going to inhabit your praises right where you're at. So you give him praise and you worship him. You don't just wait for us. You go ahead and engage and enter in. Thank him that he saved you. Thank him that that tomb was empty. Thank you that he rose from the dead. Thank you that he shed his innocent blood for you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm starting to tear up. Hallelujah. And maybe I can actually talk. Praise the Lord. I want to thank you guys for joining us this morning. And before I get into the word, and no, that wasn't my sermon. That was just getting started. So thank you for joining in. And if this is your first time to join in, welcome. We're glad you chose to worship with us this morning. And we're Lighthouse Church. We're here in Bullard. We're trusting God for to reopen this church house, amen, so that we can come back together and worship with one another. But we're taking the best of this opportunity to make sure Jesus is glorified. So if you first time joined this morning, listen, I put a link on our page where I had the lyrics. It has our website, www.lighthousechurchbullard.com. You can actually go there and click Vister and just go ahead and share your information with me so I'll know that you tuned in today for the first time. Or maybe you just started watching us the last couple of weeks and you've never been here. I would love to know that so I could reach out to you and just be able to touch base with you. And then once we do get ready to reopen, I want to invite you to come worship here with us at the church, because God is going to get us back open soon. I believe that. And there's something fixing to transpire. I believe there's going to be a great revival and we're going to see God move. And we want you to be a part of that. But also for those who want to give, you can also give on our webpage, thelighthousechurchbullard.com, or you can text to give, and I've got the instructions for that also in that post. I'm not going to spend no time doing that this morning. But man, I just want you to know we love you, and we miss you, and we just can't wait to actually get back together to worship with you. But this morning, I'm going to be sharing with you from the Word. I've got some scriptures on my computer this morning, but we're going to see how that ends up. If y'all have been watching the last couple, two or three weeks, and I would encourage you to go back and watch those sermons if you hadn't been able to do that, because God's really been speaking to me. And this morning is no different as we've been walking these aisles. I know this week I shared some Bible studies with our Lighthouse Church group, and some of you were able to hop on and do a Bible study with us on Wednesday night. And then also we had prayer and communion on Friday night, and we were able to discuss some of the things. But I know for myself that this last week I have really spent time in God's Word, studying this last week of Jesus' life up to the crucifixion and resurrection, because I want to know my Savior more. I want to know who Jesus is. Hallelujah. So if you have your Bibles, turn with me to the book of John. We're going to go to the chapter 20 of John this morning. I've got some thoughts I want to share with you, because this week I've been spending some time studying the last week of Jesus, studying his life, comparing the four Gospels. And if y'all are like me, I want to know Jesus. I want to know why Matthew said what he said about Jesus. I want to know why Mark said what he said about Jesus and so forth. But then I found myself in John, and I'm saying, Lord, why John? Why John this morning? And I want to tell you why I'm going to preach from John this morning. I'm preaching from John this morning because when John wrote his gospel, he actually wrote it many years after Matthew, Mark, and Luke did. And he wrote it at a time where Jerusalem had been overtaken and the temple had been destroyed. And the Christians had, the first church, century church had scattered and started picking up idols. And there was a lot of chaos going on. And John started writing his gospel because he was going to write it to a group of people that were lost and scattered and worried and confused and picking up idols and changing their focus from Jesus. And I said, you know what, Lord, it makes sense for me why you want me to go to John this morning, because guess what, church? We're in that same place as America right now. We're in that same place. We're scattered. We're confused. There's a little bit of worry. We don't know what's going on. And Jesus is speaking to us. And if you've ever read all four gospel accounts and you've really looked at the crucifixion week and you've seen how they talk about different things, there's a purpose behind that. There's a reason they chose the stories they chose. John chose the stories he chose because he was speaking to a group that needed to remember and know that Jesus was the way, the truth, and the life, that he was the Son of God, that he came to this earth and he did what they were saying he did. And because he did it, they can have hope and peace and salvation. So he wanted to make sure they knew that. So this morning, I find myself in the book of John because I believe John has some things he wants to say to us this morning. I'm going to read verse 30 because I want to start there. And it says, "And truly Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which were not written in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, that believing you may have life in his name." If you've ever wondered this morning why Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are not exactly the same, that's because there was so much that Jesus did while he was on earth. So many different things that if they would have wrote down everything Jesus did, this book couldn't contain it. Everyone, all four gospels, every writer had a purpose when they wrote their gospel. They had an audience. They had a reason for what they were writing. So John, his specific reason was to try to attract or to get through to a church that was scattered. A church that had been overthrown by the Roman emperor. A church that had seen their temple destroyed. So this morning, I want to start with John chapter 20, verse 1. And I want to ask you, where were you this morning early? Where were you this morning early? Were you in the bed asleep? Were you awake? Are you an early riser like me? Or did the storms wake you up? I know early in the morning it's quiet. Sometimes this morning it wasn't quiet. This Resurrection Sunday, it was rocking and rolling. There was thunder, there was lightning, there was wind. What were you doing this morning? Because 2,000 years ago, we find out that Mary Magdalene was up early. The scripture says, "Now the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early while it was still dark and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb." If you read all four accounts, you find out that there was really more than just Mary there. But for some reason, John wanted us to focus on Mary this morning, wanted us to see that it was Mary. He calls her by name. He says, "Look, she went to the tomb and she realizes the tomb was open." Where are you this morning with Jesus? Do you realize the tomb is empty? Do you realize that Jesus resurrected 2,000 years ago for you? Mary, I know, was probably heartbroken. She had just witnessed two days earlier, her Savior crucified. She had just seen all the disciples scatter to a place to go to hiding because they were afraid of what might happen next. But yet Mary said, "You know what? I've got to go to the temple and I've got to prepare my Lord's body." And when she gets there, the temple's open. The scripture doesn't say here in John that she looked in and saw that he was gone, but in the other gospels it does. So we can assume that she realizes Jesus is not there. Can you imagine how she felt that morning? Can you imagine? She looked in and her Lord and Savior was gone. She was brokenhearted already because she had been, you know, had 3 days now of no Jesus. She'd seen him crucified, but yet now somebody's taken his body. The scripture goes on to say that she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciple who John loved and said to them, "They have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Can you imagine how she felt? Some of you feel that way this morning. You're worried about what's going on in this world. You don't have any answers. You're struggling. You may have tuned in this morning by accident, or you may have tuned in because somebody told you to watch this service. I want you to know it wasn't an accident that you're here today. There's a lot going on. I know you're worried, but Jesus loves you. We're celebrating today his resurrection. There's hope in his resurrection, church. It doesn't really matter what's going on in this world because Jesus is still in control. He's going to have his way. I'm telling you, you may not believe that this morning. You may be worried, "Hey, wait a minute, something's just not going the way it should," but Jesus is going to have his way this morning. The scripture goes on and says, "Peter therefore went out and the other disciple and were going to the tomb. So they both ran together and the other disciple outran Peter and came to the tomb first. Now, if you're watching this morning, I know how Peter felt. You can smile. It's okay. Y'all can smile. I know how Peter felt to be the big guy running somewhere. Be like me and Burns running somewhere. You would outrun me, Burns. They're running to the temple, but to the tomb because they want to know what's going on. And Peter's probably chugging it, man. And here goes John flying by. Peter's probably thinking, man. But they were going to find out what was going on. And the scripture goes on and says, and he, stooping down, looking in, saw the linen clothes lying there, and yet did not go in. Then Simon Peter came. Here I come, chugging up the rear. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went in the tomb, and saw the linen clothes lying there, and the handkerchief that had been on his head, not lying with the linen clothes, but folded together in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who came to the tomb first went in also, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not know the scripture. It also says in another translation, they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise again from the dead. Then the disciples went away to their own homes. Now I'm going to read to you out of another translation about these clothings or this burial cloth, because I want you to think about something. I don't know about you, but I know when I read something, I know God did it for a reason. God put it in his word for a reason. There's always something to what Jesus has, or what God has inspired the author to pen. And I'm going to read verse 5 again. And it says, stooping down and looking in, and this is out of the Amplified Version. It says, he saw the linen wrappings neatly lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came up, following him, and went in the tomb and saw the linen wrappings neatly lying there. And the burial face cloth, which had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the other linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. And you know, I've heard this scripture preached many times over my 20 years of serving God and being in church. And praise the Lord, this is 20 years for me this year. This is my fifth year to pastor and to be preaching on Easter Sunday. And I praise God for all the sermons I've had. And I've heard different people expound on why they think the things were the way they were. Why did John make a point to say the linens were neatly laying there? Why does the Amplified Version break it down to say those cloths were neatly lying there? Why was the head garment neatly laying somewhere else? And like I say, over the years I've heard different stories. And there's some great, great inspirational stories behind it. And I'm not saying that those stories are not true or not true, but as I begin to investigate that this week and say, Lord, what are you telling us? You know, I was sharing with Wendy last night, I heard a story a few years ago about the folded napkin, meaning I'm coming back. And I thought that was really neat, and I'm not going to lie, I was going to tell that whole story today. But as I began to prepare for the sermon, the Lord spoke to me differently, and he said, I want you to think about something. And I found myself last night going back into John. Scripture says in the book of John, chapter 11, starting in verse 38, it says, then Jesus, again groaning in himself, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was laid against it. Jesus said, take away the stone. Martha, the sister of him who was dead, said to him, Lord, by this time there's a stench, for he has been dead 4 days. Jesus said to her, did I not say to you that if you would believe, you would see the glory of God? Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead man was lying, and Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank you that you've heard me. And I know you always hear me, but because the people who are standing by, I said this, that they may believe you sent me. Now when he had said these things, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. You know, something that I think about when I read that, he said, Lazarus, come forth. Did you ever realize why he said, Lazarus, come forth? Because if Jesus wouldn't have called Lazarus by name, every grave would have popped open. Did you ever figure that out? Jesus said Lazarus because if he didn't say Lazarus, everybody's popping loose. Something to think about. And the scripture says, and he died and came out bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was wrapped with a cloth, and Jesus said to him, loose him and let him go. Now the thing about the custom in Jewish tradition of burial was they would have a solid cloth on their head, and they would have bunches of little, long, thin cloths that they would wrap throughout their body. So if you get this picture of Lazarus coming out, Lazarus' hands are bound, and he's in these clothes, these grave clothes, and his feet are bound, and he's probably doing this as he's coming out, because he's all bound up, and his head's covered. And then I got this picture of all these pieces of garments, clothes wrapped around Lazarus. And I see that now, and I hear Jesus say, "Loose him and let him go." I want you to picture that. What is it going to look like when they begin to loose Lazarus? They're unwrapping these pieces of cloth, right? One at a time. Boy, they're unwrapping him. And they got all kinds of cloths laying everywhere. Right? You see that? Can you picture that? It's not neatly laying there. They're scattering them. Man, they're getting him out of them clothes because Lazarus was once dead, but now he's alive. So they're pulling all these cloths off of him and laying them to the side. And then it dawned on me what Jesus was telling me. See, in the Amplified version that I read a while ago, when it was talking about the cloths, the grave clothes, it said when Peter looked in and when John looked in, all the clothes were laying there neatly. The Amplified version expounds on it. And we get this picture that all the clothes were laying there neatly. Not just the one head garment that was folded into the side, but everything was laying there neatly. And I got this picture in my head. Nobody had to set Jesus free. The scripture tells us in Romans and in other places that the Holy Spirit raised Jesus from the dead, right? So instantaneously, when the Holy Spirit raised Jesus from the dead, he came out of those grave clothes. They were laying there neatly because no one had to unwrap him. No one had to loose him. If somebody would have come in and took the body and had to unwrap Jesus to get the body, then all those pieces of cloth would have been scattered. And I said, "Wow, I get it, Lord." And it was so powerful to John and so powerful to Peter when they saw this. It says they believed. It says they believed. Now remember, we're reading John's account of what took place then, right? We're reading John's account. He's telling the story sometime between 90 and 100 A.D., like I said, there's a lot going on, so he's writing to a group of Christians, early first church Christians, or first century Christians, that are having a lot of questions, and he's saying, "Hey, wait a minute, guys. When I walked in, there was something about those grave clothes. The second I saw them, I knew Jesus had raised from the dead. I remembered what happened to Lazarus when we had to turn him loose, when we had to take all the clothes off of him. But when I walked in and I saw neatly laying there and the head garment folded to the side or rolled up to the side, neatly laying there, I said, nobody loosed my Savior. He was resurrected out of that tomb." And man, I got this picture and I told Wendy last night, I said, it just blew me away. I said, "God, I see that picture." Can you see that picture this morning? That's why he said he saw that and he believed. That was powerful for me. And then it goes on to say that they didn't understand what Jesus had been telling them at that point, but they knew who Jesus was. They believed that he had raised from the dead. But we can go ahead and go, and I want to go a little further this morning because I think there's more in John that we can learn this morning. In verse 11, it goes on and says, "But Mary stood outside the tomb weeping. And as she wept, she stooped down and looked into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting, one on the head and one at the feet, where the body of Jesus had lain. Then they said to her, 'Woman, why are you weeping?' And she said to them, 'Because they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they've laid him.'" This morning there are probably many of us, and I say us because I'm the one talking, but there are probably many people throughout this world that may be sitting in their homes. They could be overwhelmed with grief, and they could be wondering what's going on. They're worried. I know Mary was worried. Mary was worried because she had just witnessed the crucifixion of her Lord and Savior. She had gone to prepare his body, to anoint his body, and she's realized he's not there. So she's grieving, and she's just overwhelmed with grief. And if that's you this morning, I want you to know that the Lord is with you. No matter how bad you feel, no matter how overwhelmed you are this morning, I want you to know the Lord is with you. But then the scripture goes on and it says, "Now when she had said this, she turned and saw Jesus standing there and did not know it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, 'Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?'" There's a lot of people turning to Jesus today. They may be watching because it's Easter. Maybe you're watching today and you hadn't been to church in several months. But you knew it was Easter, so you were going to tune into a service today, and you just happened to come across this service. And you said, "I'm going to watch Lighthouse Church today." There's a reason you're watching Lighthouse Church today, because Jesus wants to speak to you. Just like Mary almost 2,000 years ago, Jesus wants to speak to you. The scripture goes on to say, she, supposing him to be the gardener, said to him, "Sir, if you had carried him away, tell me where you've laid him, and I will take him away." And I love this next part. Jesus said to her, "Mary." She said to him, "Rabboni," which is to say teacher. When I was studying for this week, the Holy Spirit jumped into my heart. I want you to realize this morning, church, Jesus knows your name. Jesus knows your name. Not only does he know your name, he calls you by name. And when he calls you by name, the scripture says, you recognize his voice. Some of you watching this week, the Lord's been speaking to you. Maybe you've gotten away from the Lord, but you can hear him calling your name. That's why you're on here today watching. You're on here today watching because the Holy Spirit has been speaking to you, and you are being drawn back to Jesus. Don't miss this opportunity. Make this Resurrection Sunday the one that changes your eternity. Jesus then goes on to say, "Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father. But go to my brethren and say to them, 'I am ascended to my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God.'" Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord and that he had spoken to her these things. Verse 19 goes on to say, "Then that same evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut where the disciples were assembled, for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in their midst." And we'll finish that scripture, but I want you to think about something this morning. Where was the church 2,000 years ago? Where were they? Where was the church on Resurrection Sunday 2,000 years ago? They were locked in their homes, afraid. Where's the church at today? They're in their homes. Many are afraid. I get it now, Lord. I get it why you wanted me and John today. Then he goes on and says to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. That jumps out to me as well this morning, because when Jesus shows up, there's still a lot of question in their mind, what's going on here. So instead of Jesus just start grilling, "Why are y'all locked in your house? Why are y'all hiding? Why are you this?" He goes, "Hey, come here a minute, guys. Check this out. Look at my scars." Pulls his thing up, says, "Look." Why did he do that? Because he loved them, just like he loves us. And he wanted them to be assured of who he was. And man, that just speaks volumes to me, that our Lord loves us so much, he wants to do everything in his power to make us understand who he is. Then he goes on in verse 21, and it says, "Jesus said to them again, 'Peace to you. As the Father has sent me, I also send you.' And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, 'Receive the Holy Spirit. If you have forgiven the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained.'" Verse 24, Now Thomas, called the twin and one of the twelve, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples therefore said to him, "We have seen the Lord." So he said to them, "Unless I see the hand, the handprint of the nails, and put my fingers in the print of the nails, and put my hand in his side, I will not believe." Some of you watching today are just like Thomas. I'm not going to believe in Jesus unless Jesus shows up and I see the handprint, the nail prints in his hands, unless I see the hole in his side, unless he reveals himself to me supernaturally, I'm just not going to believe. That's okay, because guess what? Jesus wants you to believe. And Jesus will do everything in his power to help you believe. The scripture goes on to say, it says, after 8 days, his disciples were again inside, and Thomas was with them. Jesus came, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst and said, "Peace to you." Then he said to Thomas, "Reach your fingers in here and look at my hands. Reach your hand here and put it in my side. Do not be unbelieving, but believe." And man, when I read that, it excites me. Because you know what he could have done to Thomas? "Oh, ye a little faith. I can't believe you don't believe who I said. You hung out with me all these years. You saw all these miracles. And you just don't believe. Shame on you." Have you ever thought that's what Jesus was going to do to you? "I don't really want to go to church, because if I go to church, man, Jesus is not going to accept me. I've done a lot of crazy stuff in my life. I've been there. I understand. I was the one that was afraid to step in the church because I was afraid the roof was going to fall on my head. Yes, I was that guy." But I want you to know something this morning. That's not what Thomas did or what Jesus did to Thomas. He didn't go to Thomas and say, "Oh, you worthless, no good, lack of faith person. I can't believe all the things you did." He said, "No, Thomas, look. Come here, I want you to see the scars. I want you to put your hands in the scars. And I want you to believe." And then Thomas answered and said, "My Lord and my God." Now that one scripture is so powerful to who Jesus really is. Because I want you to understand, back in the days of Jesus, the Jewish custom was, if you referred to someone other than God, you didn't even say the name God for one. They didn't do that. They didn't believe you should do that. But if you referred to someone as God, they would have stoned you and killed you on the spot. But yet Thomas looks at Jesus and says, "My Lord and my God." And Jesus doesn't stone him. Matter of fact, no one in the room does anything, but Jesus answers him. And I'm sure Jesus smiles at Thomas and is like, "Hey, you got it, Thomas." And he says, "Thomas, because you have seen me, you have believed. But blessed are those who have not seen, yet have believed." See, this morning you're in your homes and you're struggling because you don't have Jesus showing up and holding out his hands and saying, "See the scars?" You don't have Jesus doing that. So you're saying, "Well, you know what, Pastor Wayne? I'm going to believe this morning if Jesus shows up in my house and shows me the scars like Thomas, like he did Thomas." He's not going to do that this morning. The scripture says that Thomas was blessed because he saw and believed. But it's our place to not see and believe. Amen. We have to put our faith in the risen Savior. We have to put our faith in what John has written almost 2,000 years ago to be true. We have to put our faith in the fact that Jesus did all these things that John is describing to us. And as he describes them, they come alive to us and we say, "That is the Jesus I want to believe in." Because Jesus is not going to come in your house today. If you're waiting for him to show up and show you the scars, he's not coming. But he is sending people with the word who are saying, "Believe, trust, Jesus loves you." So wherever you're at this morning, you're struggling to believe. Today's the day. Today's the day where you can put all this aside and say, "Lord Jesus, I believe in you. I heard the word. I've heard a bunch of sermons. I hadn't been living the way I should. I've had a lot of doubt in my life." Guess what? Thomas did too. He had a lot of doubt. Thomas walked with Jesus. Thomas saw the miracles, but yet he had tons of doubt. This morning, you can let all that doubt be gone, pushed aside, if you will just stop and place your faith in Jesus. One final point this morning. If you'll turn in your Bibles one more time to the book of Acts, chapter 2, verse chapter 1. And I've got the scripture here I'm going to read to you. Jesus is resurrected. Amen. He is alive. The tomb is empty.
Yes, he is.
He walked on earth for 40 days. He ate. He taught. He fellowshipped with the disciples. And then in Acts chapter 1, verse 9, the scripture says, "Now when he had spoken these things, while they watched, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly towards the heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, who also said, 'Men of Galilee, why do you stand gazing up into the heaven? This same Jesus,'" I want you to get that today, church, "'this same Jesus, who was taken up from you to heaven, will so in like manner, as you saw him go into heaven, return.'" This morning, church, I want you to know something. Jesus is resurrected. He has ascended to the Father. He is now seated at the right hand. He is making intercession for you and I. His desire is that you will be saved. But church, there's coming a day, and that day I believe to be very soon, that the same Jesus they saw ascend. And let me tell you something, it wasn't just two or three of them. The Bible says in Corinthians there was over 500 people witnessed the ascension. Over 500 witnesses to seeing Jesus going up into heaven. The same people who witnessed his crucifixion had saw Jesus as he walked on this earth 40 days after his resurrection. They saw him ascend to heaven. So it's not like Luke's just telling a story here. Eyewitnesses saw Jesus ascend. And the angel said, that same Jesus is coming back. And I know without a shadow of a doubt today that no matter what's going on in this world, that no matter how terrible things may seem to get, my Jesus is coming back. And I want you to know that. It's not too late this very moment for you to give your heart and life to Jesus. You can right now place your faith in Jesus. But he's coming back for a pure, spotless bride. This Easter, the greatest gift you can receive is the salvation of the Lord. So I pray today that as you've been listening to the word, God has been speaking to you. The Bible says if we lift Jesus up, he will draw all men into him. I believe he's speaking to you right there in your home. And I believe you have heard his voice as he's called out to you. All you have to do is give your life to Jesus. Give it to him. Repent. It's easy. The Bible says if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, believe in your heart that he died and rose again, you shall be saved. That's easy. It sounds easy, but it's actually difficult because you've got to make that step. You have to make that step this morning. You have to go and say, "Jesus, I am a sinner. I have sinned a bunch." That's what I had to tell him. Guess what? I tell him that a whole lot. "Jesus, I'm a sinner. But I want you to be Lord of my life. Forgive me. Help me turn from my sin that I may not ever sin again." And then when I sin again, I go back and I ask forgiveness again. But all you have to do today is go to Jesus and say, "Lord Jesus, forgive me." And the scripture says that if you confess your sin, he is just and faithful to forgive you from all and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. So today, give your heart to Jesus. This Easter is about the resurrection. Guys, without the resurrection, we'd have no hope. Without the resurrection, we would have no answer. But I have an answer today because, guys, 2,000 years ago, that tomb was empty. The tomb was empty. Christ is risen. And he rose for you and I. I love you. Be blessed. Sorry for the confusion today. Hopefully next week it'll be a little better. Bless you.